evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this month's Startup Thursday. My name is Matsi Mudise. I am the managing director of Simodisa, which is an industry association for entrepreneurs, like everybody in the house, by entrepreneurs. And our aim is to connect our country's fragmented entrepreneurship ecosystem. We aim to be the golden thread. We do that by lobbying, advocacy, policy review, and recommendation. We do research. We do a lot of engagements with entrepreneurs on the ground because we believe that they are the next frontier for our country's growth. So welcome, everybody. Startup Thursday is Simodisa's flagship initiative on a monthly basis, and it's about creating this community, connecting this community of these people we call entrepreneurs. And the idea behind it is to share knowledge, information, business-to-business trading. Amongst all of you, there's a product or service you have. And what better network we have tonight than you to sell what you have to sell. So utilize this platform. The idea behind it is that we have investors, we have mentors, we have accelerators, and you're probably wondering, why do you have a green, a red, or an orange tag? Well, those who are wearing green are the entrepreneurs. You know, they are the people that are freshly ground. These are the people that are going to change our economy. Those who are wearing red, we have far and few of them, but if you do find them, these are the funders, the investors. So those are the people you ideally want to speak to. And then the ones that are wearing orange are people that are either incubators, accelerators, or mentors. And initially, Simodisa wanted to create this platform so that people can connect, because entrepreneurship is a very, very lonely road. Tonight's theme is Youth Unleashed. They're young, they're gifted, and they are South African. And in commemorating all of those youth that made those risks, that took those brave steps to stand up for what they believe, we thought that we would put together a shit-hot panel of young South Africans that have basically charted their own paths, taken their own destinies in their own hands. And we thought that this is a time to inspire one another, because within each and every one of us, there's a story to tell. And yes, it so happens that the four that we've selected tonight are those who are making great strides, especially in the technology space of our country. So can we give our panel a warm hand of applause? Wonderful. So our panelists tonight, well, we're going to start with Annabel. She is the founder of Stock Shop. We're going to then come to Arlene Mulder. She is the founder of WeThinkCode. And then on my left, we have Aisha Pandor, and she's the founder of SweepSouth. And then we have Dario. Dario, you have a very interesting surname. I'm not even going to try pronounce it, but you are one of the co-founders of Isazi Consulting. So with that, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to start our panel. So if you don't mind me asking, this is a platform where we are very honest with one another, because we have to be very honest. Entrepreneurship is not about the people that you read on the covers of Forbes. Aisha, case in point. She was one of the people that were featured on Forbes magazine, I think the April issue. Yes. So, I mean, you see all of these pictures, you see all their successes, but there's definitely the truth and the story behind it. So my first question to my panelists would be, how old are you? Because we must believe that you're young. And also, what did you study at varsity?
Oh my goodness, what a question. I'm 29, and I studied mechanical engineering, focusing on nuclear design. It's my passion. Yeah, I guess that's the question.
Brilliant, brilliant. Thank you very much.
I can't believe you're asking girls how old we are.
Honestly,
so I'm 31, and I studied business, mathematics, and informatics. Pretty much actuarial science, did a master's degree in that.
I think the fact that they're being honest shows the reality to who these people are really, truly, and what they've done within a very short space of time on this planet. Aisha, how old are you, and what did you study?
I'm 31. And I studied human genetics, so I did a thesis on gene therapy. I finished a PhD in that, and then I also, in the last year of my PhD, studied a business qualification at UCT Graduate School of Business.
Brilliant. Dario?
I'm 29, and I did mathematics and computer science back in the day.
Wonderful. Well,
all
They're all somehow very smart. They all did some science of sorts, but they also decided to take those huge risks with a lot of people, statistically speaking, would not be able to take. So congratulations to you all. Dario, tell us briefly about your encounter working in the academic institutions.
Right, so for a while I worked as a lecturer at WITS, and I've got to say, the day I left was the day I stopped learning, stopped studying and started learning, to be honest, because it's a great experience, it's a really brilliant job, I mean, not to bash it at all. You learn a lot, you teach people, you do research, but going out and starting something that's really going to make an impact and really trying to do something in the country is just so much more exciting.
Brilliant. Aisha, management consulting, studying in the science. Tell us more about your exposure or experience in corporate South Africa, which is, I believe, a lot of people start there. They somehow figure out that, well, there's more to life. Let me quit. Let me take all the risks and let me start my business. So tell us about your experience working for a corporate.
So I moved from doing research and, like Dario, just feeling very much like it was this very closed, protected environment where I was learning a lot but not actually doing things that were broadly applicable to South Africans in general. And so that's why I decided to work in management consulting. And the experience for me was almost like going into something that I didn't like, into something that I hated even more, because I thought that I would have more freedom and be able to make better decisions myself. But actually, as a management consultant, and again, it's a really great job. It was a great learning curve. I learned a lot working in different industries about different businesses and how to improve them. But I was essentially working for a company that was working for another company. So I now had two people that I was reporting to, and I think. Part of that experience was just realizing within myself that I wanted to do something where I was master of my own destiny and where it wasn't about always having to report to someone else about decisions that I made, and also having to have someone else in charge of my career, how much I get paid, when I get promoted, how many hours I work.
Brilliant. Arlene, the famous banker, tell us about your experience working in at Rand Merchant Bank.
So RMB was my first job. I joined the graduate program. So for 2 years, I spent in credit risk coding and building the credit risk rating models. And after that, I moved into corporate finance. So I spent 5 years in M&A advisory. And I must say, I loved it. I learned so much there. But there was always kind of the something in me that wanted to do something that makes a difference, if that makes sense. And I kind of had this little promise to myself that I need to resign before I turn 30. So I literally resigned a week before my 30th birthday. But it was because of RMB and working at RMB, first of all, that I saw the opportunity to start WeThinkCode, the massive skills gap. But second of all, I don't think, if I didn't have that experience of the 5 years in corporate finance, the contacts that I made, I don't underestimate that. I'm not sure I would have been able to, as quickly, I guess, get the business up and running.
Brilliant, Arlene, brilliant. Annabel, Johannesburg Stock Exchange, your experience there.
So very similar, actually. Started Standard Bank grad program in CIB. Also then moved into the JSE, ran one of their markets and evaluations team for them, and very quickly realized the issue in the market, and the business was born, and a second business was born out of that. And just was so incredibly frustrated that no one was doing this or fixing this problem that I just couldn't live another day watching it just atrophy. So, yep.
Brilliant. Wonderful. Stock Shop, from idea to execution. Tell us about Stock Shop and also tell us about your journey thus far.
The one thing I'll say is it's just damn hard. It's so hard. Oh, my goodness. But it's good. It's really rewarding when it is good. So StockShop is a financial technology business, and we build solutions. Well, we've got a toolbox of platforms that we white label for banks and financial institutions to help them remain relevant to millennials, unbanked, underbanked, among other things. StockShop really actually started with me. We've got 15 employees, and we are servicing the top three banks and 20 of the next tier institutions, and we're moving into Africa, we're moving to Singapore as well, so we're looking at Asia quite aggressively. So it's been quite a roller coaster ride, but it's been worth every second. But it's, I will leave with that, it is just damn hard.
famous last words. Arlene, tell us about WeThinkCode. It's something that is popping up everywhere. Everybody's talking about it. It's talking about how it's changing young minds. It's giving opportunities to those who don't have opportunities. So tell us about, from the idea of creating WeThinkCode to now its inception, what is WeThinkCode about?
So it started with seeing that every single company and the world is going through this digital revolution. But what I saw, especially at R&B, was, you know, there was the deal makers and there was what you thought was IT, which even me, who was in, or was coding and can code, thought of the guy in the basement fixing your printer. But there wasn't someone kind of in the middle, a technologist that could solve problems in this digital world. So going through that, I then met my co-founder, she's from France, and we found this incredible model in Paris. It's called Ecole 42. And they said, okay, if we can create a new kind of university in technology, how would it look? So I would say, so we partnered with them to get our curriculum and content. But I would say that WeThinkCode, we're different in two ways. So first of all, we want to make it open and accessible to anyone. So anyone can apply, 17 to 35 years old. You don't even need matric to apply, so no previous education. And it's completely free to students. Then secondly is the way that students learn. So there's no teachers, there's no classes. You do have to come into campus, but it's this gamification system. So what we really want to do is we want to develop the digital problem solvers of the future. So yes, they learn to code, but they really learn how to solve problems using coding as this tool.
Wonderful. Thank you, Arlene. Aisha, do tell us about your journey, but also do mention how it all happened, because there's a special Simodisa twist to it.
So just briefly, what SweepSouth is it's a platform, a tech platform, that connects domestic cleaners who are looking for work, and obviously who are experienced, with homeowners who are looking for someone to provide that service at their house. And so we're focused on two sides of a market. For the cleaners, we're trying to provide work at decent rates and in a reliable way, and in a way that suits their schedule. And for homeowners, we're trying to provide a very quick, convenient, and hassle-free solution to getting that home help. And the way that we started the business is, so my founder is my husband as well, which is probably a whole nother topic for a panel discussion. We were both working in corporate jobs at the time, living in Johannesburg, and we were on holiday in Cape Town and came across the issue where we needed the service. We needed something like SweepSouth, but obviously it wasn't available. And so in order to get someone to help us with home cleaning, we went through classified ads, asking friends for referrals, eventually went to agencies, and the kind of the situation that we saw in terms of how domestic cleaners are treated in South Africa, but also treated and paid, but also for us, that long process of trying to find someone and a very unpredictable process led us to the idea of starting this business. And so we launched it in the middle of 2014, after building the platform for about 5 months, 4 or 5 months, and then and built it out of Cape Town. And we really started off a very, very low base. I was the first customer on the platform. First month, I think we had two customers. We're now doing thousands a month, but we at that time had two customers in the first month. Next month, 4 or 5 customers, and just kept on building very quickly, but off a low base. And at the end of that year, we decided to try the idea of launching somewhere remotely. So we said, you know what, let's look at it as an experiment. Let's go to Cape Town. Try and launch the business by presenting at a tech conference and presenting to early adopters who would hopefully become our customers. And then let's go back to Joburg and let's see whether we can run this platform remotely from Johannesburg. And so we went to Simodisa Startup SA, went and did a pitch there, just again with the idea of wanting to pitch to these potential customers, and ended up winning the pitching competition and meeting our investors there.
Wonderful. Tell us about your journey to Silicon Valley. That is also quite special.
Yeah. So again, we often, when we talk about our story, it's funny because I'm against kind of going to too many events and pitches and things just for the sake of doing it. But I think what was lucky for us with pitching at Simodisa was that it was one that was the catalyst for so many of these amazing things that then happened further down the line. And so one of the organizations that was at Simodisa Startup SA was an organization called an ecosystem called Startup Grind. And they had seen us pitch and were quite impressed and kept us in mind and followed our journey for the next 6 months or so after that. And they had the opportunity then to put together or to put forward a couple of startups from South Africa to be considered by Y Combinator and 500 Startups, which are these two accelerators based in Silicon Valley, and they're considered the top two in the world and very, very competitive to get into. And so they approached us and said, are you guys interested in applying? We put together an application very, very last minute. Alan was actually, we were living in Johannesburg. Alan was in Cape Town, and he arrived at 11 p.m. Back in Johannesburg, and I said, Alan, we've got 2 hours to put together an application for 500 Startups and Y Combinator. And so we were making videos, you know, pitching to them and doing all sorts of things. Ended up submitting at 1 a.m. in the morning, just making the deadline, and then got into 500 Startups.
Congratulations. Dario, Isazi Consulting, I know it's a bunch of very, very smart people that do very, very smart solutions. So tell us about it.
So we actually started out, so when I was an academic, we used to run, we used to be part of a workshop called MISG. It's basically where, what we used to do is ask, and it still runs now, and we're still involved, used to ask academics from around the world to come and bring their PhD students and bring their master's students. And then we used to go to companies and say, do you have problems that you have trouble solving? Like really tough things that maybe you'd ask a mathematician to give a crack at. So you have to really be desperate. And what would happen is we'd get some people, and we had some repeat customers who would keep coming back. And we made it free to industry, we made it free to the academics, because the idea was the academics get publications out of it, which the government subsidizes, the industry gets a problem solved. It was really successful. But what used to happen is people would come to us afterwards and say, so when's the next one? So when can we do this again? We'd say, well, next year. And that wasn't acceptable. You know, in any business, I think a year is a very long time to wait. And we had so much demand. Eventually, we just said, we're kind of almost pushed into it. So start something and start providing these kinds of solutions to people, this kind of atmosphere, this very problem-solving, intensive atmosphere. And that evolved into Isazi. As we know it, that was
what
in 2012.
What does Isazi mean?
Isazi means scientist or bearer of knowledge in isiZulu. It's interesting because my co-founder, Obakeng, it's Swana. So I was asking him for names, and he was like, well, I don't know what this means. But we found it eventually.
Brilliant, awesome, great. So I just believe that, you know, starting a business is a journey. It's different for every sector, every industry, for every person. And I'd like for you to share with our audience, at what stages are your businesses? Are you profitable? Are you broke? Are you break even? So that we bring the reality to it. I mean, the reason why I ask these very, well, not hard questions, but honest questions is, you know, a lot of the people in the room here are starting up, you know, and it's very important for us to give the reality of your journey. So where are you? How, when did you start the business? Are you year five or are you year three? And where are you right now in business?
Okay, so we're 2.5 years old. We are profitable.
Yay.
Stressful, but it's good. We bootstrapped for a long time. When we started, we didn't actually fundraise. I didn't want to give away too much equity initially. And I wanted to figure out what this animal was before I started just kind of handing out chunks of it to people. And so I bootstrapped, which basically you fund the business just through bringing in revenue, and it was very patchy, very difficult. There were nights where I thought, why am I doing this? Oh my word, this is a very slow uptick if you are bootstrapping, especially in this market, because scale isn't as easy to get as you would in an American market where the customer base is just millions. I mean, here we've really, really got to hustle to bootstrap a business. So we did actually get investors in, not because I'm anti-investors or because bootstrapping was too hard. It was just the right time for the business. We started scaling. And in order to scale appropriately, I think there comes a point in time where you either have to make a decision to keep bootstrapping as you go or to really give it a good shot. So we raised funding. Obviously, who you raise from is critical. We didn't want money for money's sake. We wanted the right investor in the business with the right network. We were very lucky in that we found two incredible angels. And now we are in another kind of growth phase, I guess, as we move across borders. And we, again, are scaling fairly aggressively, so we're moving into the next round of funding. And we'll see. It's 2.5 years down.
Thank you, Annabel.
So we started the WeThinkCode journey 18 months ago, and we opened our doors to the first students in January this year. And similar to what you're saying, we also decided to go the lean startup approach. So at the time, so we had spent, I think, 10,000 rand to a friend of mine from high school designed a logo for us. We went out and we said, okay, before we do anything, before we get a building, before we spend any money, before we get salaries, we need to find revenue first. So we had this tech leader challenge that was our deadline. We had to get, so our business model is a little bit different. So we get the corporate sponsors to sponsor students. But we signed up 11 million rand in revenue even before we opened our student applications. So that would be my advice, is really, don't try and go spend all this money and invest and build all this stuff. Really, the whole bootstrapping way, I really think that's the way to go. Try get it out there as soon as possible. And as far as possible, try to get revenue signed up. So we've not raised any capital. Everything has been revenue so far. And, well, we raised as much as we thought we needed. So I would say maybe break even.
Okay, brilliant. Give her a hand. Come on, please, guys. Encouraging hand. Profitable, break even. They are still in business. They're still pushing. That's what's important. Aisha?
So we also bootstrapped for the first 6 months after launching. By that time, we'd gone a year without any salaries or any kind of outside investment or input into the business. And it's been quite an interesting funding journey because we met our investors then towards the end of that year and raised a seed round. But we actually then decided to wait a little bit before we raised, after we ran out of that money. And so we ended up selling our house and our car even after we had investment. So it, you know, it's not just this kind of smooth journey where the business gets investment after investment. And where we are now, so it's 2 years, the business is 2 years old. We celebrated our second anniversary in June. And we've decided to focus on growth. So along with our investors, and this is very important, they obviously have to be on board with this decision. We've decided to focus on growth and really look at capturing the markets that we're in and capitalizing on our first mover advantage before we look at becoming profitable. So that's kind of been, if you think of an Uber or an Airbnb, you know, why do these multi-billion dollar companies keep on raising money? It's pretty much the same thing, is that you want to go out there and capture markets, but you need to be able to demonstrate that you are able to become profitable.
Dario?
So I think in our case, it was a little different. We actually had a lot of exposure before we even started. So we had a couple of clients lining up, and what it meant was just the three of us could kick this thing off and do all the work ourselves. And instead of investors, we just had initial sort of work that we did. And from the start, we had kind of three models to make money. The first was your typical consulting model, just selling hours. But then we also, because we were in a surprising situation where we were making enough capital to start putting it back into the business and trying other things, we also did two other models where we were able to sort of build partnerships with people who are distribution channels for new products that we build and take them out to market. We're doing a lot of exciting stuff in media now where we can listen to radio stations and know what's on and tell when people switching channels and tell advertisers, ooh, you know, your advert's not so nice, people always switching whenever it's on. And then the third model is, you know, more where we retain a library of algorithms. As we write these things as we go, we keep our own sort of intrinsic toolkit. And then as we get new clients, we're able to license quick solutions out to them that use this IP. And then that's a really quick turnaround for them. And we get revenue on an annual basis. So we're profitable right now. We've been from day one, surprisingly.
Brilliant. Wonderful. Great. Oh, yes, of course, a hand. Wonderful. Annabel, you've expressed, you know, often this evening that it's tough. It's not easy. But tell us, what keeps you going? What keeps you pushing? You know, if there's one thing that you keep reminding yourself, are you doing this for your country or are you doing this for your mother? You know, there's always that one thing that just keeps you going. What is it?
Yeah, I don't know if anyone plays golf, but it's a bit like playing a round of golf. There's always one shot that makes you come back. So if you're having a bad day, there's always one moment where you think, oh, okay, maybe I can come tomorrow and try this one again. I think having an incredible support network. Mm-hmm. So when I first started the business, it's quite a personal story. I was in a relationship, not very supportive, and it actually affected the business quite fundamentally. It set us back, I would say, at least 6 months. just because I didn't have a support structure that was there, that understood the journey of an entrepreneur and that you're working 18 hours a day and, you know, you have to forfeit some luxuries in life. So having a support network has pulled me through consistently. Friends, family, followers, whoever it may be, that's really helped. What keeps me going? A lot of different things. So creating jobs has been an incredible motivator for me. The staff we have, every day they come to work, the stories they tell, the way we've changed, fundamentally changed their lives. I mean, our first employee, Noni, called me aside the other day and said, "You've changed my whole family's life. You don't understand how this business has impacted us." So we forget those things. We forget the knock-on effect we actually are having. And, you know, I'm so tired of the government saying we need to create 1,000 jobs. Rather help 1,000 businesses employ 10 people each, you know. So that's what's driving me at the moment is further job creation. But also, I'm very passionate about the financial services sector and how bad it is and how flawed it is. And what drives me is the fact that we can change it. And we get to design the financial services space of the future. We don't have to bank with the banks anymore. We can put our foot down and say, listen, actually, we're not happy about the fees we're paying. We're not happy about the service we're receiving. We're going to use tech in a clever way to disrupt this, and that's what we're doing. So I get a lot of joy out of that.
Brilliant. That journey. Oh, brilliant. Awesome. Thank you, Annabel. Arnett, being young, do you see it as an advantage or disadvantage? And also, would you use it as an advantage and how?
Wow. I think it's maybe an advantage because maybe often if you're young, you think you can just do anything. Or maybe that's an entrepreneurial trait because actually the rest of my team say I'm the one that's just always positive. I'll meet someone and I'll say, oh, definitely, like they're going to be a client. So I think maybe being young, you believe you can do anything. Mm-hmm. So I would say definitely that it is. But I guess sometimes also... And I don't know if we should go into that, but, you know, being a woman and being young, then people underestimate you and they don't think that you'll be able to do it. And sometimes they don't take you seriously. But it can also be an advantage. Prove them wrong.
Sure, absolutely. I totally agree to that. Taking the plunge, making those risks, you know, what's been your biggest sacrifice? You know, the one thing, I mean, Annabel mentioned foregoing some luxuries. What is the one thing that you've had to sacrifice through this journey?
I think the biggest thing and the thing that I've come to value the most is time, is the amount of time that we've put into the business. And I mean, it's completely normal for me to work 18 to 20 hour days, like for months on end. And it's all consuming. You know, weekends are just, there's no notion of weekends. It's just the week, 1 week runs into another. So I think one of the biggest sacrifices has been time and having control over your own time. And it's something that I think a lot of entrepreneurs struggle with, but that you have to kind of get back and get a handle on, because it can be very damaging to you physically and mentally and emotionally. And then also in line with that, I decided to go into business with my husband. And it's been difficult to separate business from having a personal relationship. And so, you know, like Annabel was saying, ours is actually the complete opposite, where it's not the case of someone who doesn't support you, but it's the case of two people who are so passionate about this business that's actually all you talk about and all you think about. And so although it's been fantastic and he's an amazing business partner, we just have to keep an eye on the fact that, you know, we're a married couple as well. And then there are also material sacrifices. So we had to, you know, we've got a 7-year-old daughter. We've got another one on the way.
Congratulations. Hand of applause. Congratulations.
Thanks. Yeah. And I don't know, maybe we were just foolish or naive or whatever it is, but you know, we decided to take a risk with all of those responsibilities and, you know, and sell our house. And our daughter was old enough to actually say, like, you know, what's happening to our house? Like, and when we had to hand over the key, she was kind of like, well, who are these people? And, you know, can I still swim in my swimming pool? And so that's been tough. It's been tough, and it's not something to be taken lightly.
Thank you, Aisha. Thank you so much for sharing. Dario, your biggest sacrifice or sacrifices?
Sure. Well, I think, you know, I was on quite an academic trajectory before, and I did very well for myself. I mean, I collected a lot of awards at WITS. It was nice. I was doing very well. I was up and coming. Everyone was like, you know, we had the Dean of Science for WITS speak at our company today, and he told me when we were walking in, I always thought you were going to be an academic. and I think, you know, I suppose moving away from that and into something completely unguaranteed and unknown, and at first not always... I mean, now it's the most exciting thing. I wake up every day. It's so fun. I mean, we had one of our employees make a 30 seconds game that reads a book and then asks you questions from the book. Wow. And that we just had an even. It's cool. It's just fun to go to work. But in the beginning, I think, you know, you have to set things up, and it's not this super exciting in the beginning. You have to do all the hard work. You have to get it set up. And I suppose, you know, I feel like now I'm on like a wonder trajectory, and it's great. But, you know, getting there, it didn't always feel like the dream job.
Oh, I see. So not big sacrifices. Sounds like you're having a time of your life. It's one big ball of fun.
Yeah, I mean, you
it's
have
also,
to
It's also
you
allowed
do.
Not to have sacrifices.
Yeah.
Okay, brilliant. So, guys, before I open up questions to the audience, if there's one thing you would like to tell aspiring entrepreneurs about this journey, about starting a business, about contributing towards the growth of our country, about redefining who we are as young South Africans, what would it be?
I don't know if this is the right way to put it, but start yesterday. If you've got an idea, like, yesterday's too late. Start, like, as soon as you can. It's scary, and everyone's scared when they start, and it's hell of a daunting. It's a big world out there, but if you don't start, you'll never know. You have to test it. You've got to try. There's an incredible support system here in this room alone with AlphaCode, Samadisa. There's people out there who will have your back and who will help you. So, and when we started, a lot of these people weren't there. So it's getting easier and easier every day. So start now.
Brilliant. Thank you, Annabel.
I actually agree. I think if I thought about it too much, I would never have left R&B. You just kind of have to go. And a lot of people have good ideas, but not a lot of people actually do it. So I think the same as you, just go and do it. And the last thing is maybe to ask for help. I think we're not very good with that. So, you know, just ask. There's a lot of people, like you say, in this room, and just ask. You'll be surprised how many people will actually help you. I've been surprised, the things that people have just done for us and given us. But I had to ask. No one's going to just give it to you. So go out and ask.
Brilliant. Go out there and ask for it. Aisha?
Mine would be to build something that creates value for people. So I think sometimes you get caught up in the idea of entrepreneurship and it looks sexy and it's like, you know, this whole Silicon Valley and startups are so cool, but you need to build something that creates value for people. Otherwise, there's no point in your business. And then once you've identified that thing, to focus on that and really just be kind of razor sharp focus on building on that thing and not get distracted, because you know, once you do start becoming successful, lots of people want to speak to you and, you know, want you to kind of go into all sorts of different types of things. And you really need to just maintain focus.
Brilliant. Dario?
Can I turn this into a math problem?
Of course you can.
I think the important thing to do is think about time. You've got 24 hours in a day. You've got something like 8,000 hours in a year. Think about what you're doing with your time. I think, what is that going to create? And what can you do to other people's time? Look at successful companies. Look at Facebook. Everyone, 1 billion people spend an hour on Facebook a day. Facebook uses up more lifetimes than the populations of some countries per day. That's a big change to the world. And if you just add up the hours of what you're going to do and who you're going to influence, and if you just add up your hours and what that's going to mean for your life, I find that that's the most valuable thing to think about.
Oh, brilliant. On that note, I'm going to now open to the floor. I'm going to take the first three questions. So who are the first to ask some questions? Ndaba. Who else is going to ask a question? All right, there's a question in the back. And then the third one. Third question. Okay, we'll start with the first two.
All right. No, you've got three questions. Don't worry.
Oh.
Yeah. So the first question, Ms. Pandor, a lot of people say that having a child is the best savings plan in the world. It will really motivate you. But you started after you had your firstborn. Do you think, having gone through that, was that preferable for you? Do you think it would have been easier if your child wasn't around yet, if you had done it before? And then to the whole panel, including you, Martin.
Me?
Mm. For some reason, there's this, I don't know what to call it, where startup, the word startup, the idea of a startup is associated with tech. While every company is supposed to use technology to do better business, not every company is a tech company. Why is that? Why is it that someone starting a spaza doesn't refer to it as a startup?
Okay, interesting question. All right, our third question.
Yes, so my question is in terms of age versus being an effective entrepreneur. So it goes like this. If there would be a magic number in terms of age, what would it be for someone to now say, I can be an effective entrepreneur?
Okay, interesting question. Is it to anybody or everybody?
It depends on time. You'll be the judge.
I suppose we have two good questions. So, well, three good questions. We can all answer that question. Dario, we're going to start with you.
Which question am I answering?
So I think it's such a difficult one to answer. I think so there are benefits and there are definite kind of drawbacks to starting a business, particularly. And so let me go back to what you were saying about a startup first. So there's an actual official definition of a startup, and what it is it's a business that you start in a market where that hasn't existed before. So either it's a completely new concept or it's a concept that didn't exist in that market before. And then the second element is that it's high growth. So and often that high growth is facilitated through technology. So that's in terms of that term. And so and why I'm answering that first is because by the nature of what a startup is, I think it's particularly hard to build a startup when you have a family. Because it's high growth, it's high intensity. Often because it's a new market, it means they're going to be competitors that will follow behind you and you've got to defend that. And so there's a lot of effort that goes into it, and it's not the same as building a lifestyle business that's a lot more, you know, it's slower pace. And so I think for, I mean, just in terms of my experience, a lot of the things that I think make women good entrepreneurs, I think make parents good entrepreneurs. So, you know, you've already got a lot of responsibilities. You're already juggling a lot of different roles that you're playing. And you already, I think, are used to, in a sense, being an underdog. And I think those are things that, yes, they can be drawbacks, but you can use them to your advantage as well. And so for me, with parenting, you know, I'm used to the idea of multitasking. I understand how I need to break up a day to be able to make that day as effective as possible. And so it's been a strength. But yeah, you know, there are obvious drawbacks. You know, there's, I mean, I'm sure my daughter's going to come back to me when she's 15, 16, 17 and say I didn't spend enough time with her and that's why she's a rebel and whatever else. So, yeah.
Thank you, Aisha. I think the second question I would like Arlene to actually answer that, because, you know, she's a coding queen.
No, but I think your point was correct. I think technology often helps you to scale very quickly, and you don't need a lot of capital often. I mean, building an app, for example, you don't need a lot of money to do that. And I think it's a lot easier for almost anyone and a lot of people with access to technology at a low cost to start a new business and also to scale it. So, I mean, if we think how small our teams are, I mean, we've got a team of 6 people, and we use technology, so we don't have any teachers. Why can we do this? Because we have technology. We could we had 30,000 applications that we think of, and we could do that through technology. If we had to look at every single application, we could never have done that. So I think that's the main reason why tech is getting all this attention.
Great, Daria, I'd like for you to answer Dario and Annabel.
Can we build a model to figure out
the age at which to become an entrepreneur? Is that the question?
Yeah, essentially. Like, what's the magic age?
Sure. I mean, I think it's the age at which you take the plunge. I mean, I've seen people in all walks of life. I've seen people who've retired from their work and think that's the right time to start a company. And there's youngsters who leave school to start companies. I mean, I think if you catch the bug, there is no age. I mean, I suppose I could do data science on this. I could collect all entrepreneurs when they started their companies and determine which ones are successful and show you a histogram.
Let's do that. Yeah, I'm not sure I want to go after that. Like ditto. Jesus. I'm not sure. Any age. I think I've seen multiple entrepreneurs start at 50, 60, 20. I started my first business selling my parents' alcohol back to them on holiday when I was 12. So, like, I don't know. Whenever it strikes you, I think.
Brilliant. Last set of questions. Okay. First question. There's one at the back. And there's one here at the front. Great. Can you tell us who you are and tell us your question?
So, I'm Brian. And I actually work at Purple Group, but I've got my own thing on the side.
So how important is goals for you as an individual and for the success of your business to date?
Anybody in particular?
Anyone on the panel can answer.
Second question is at the back. Can you come to the front?
Okay. Cool. Hi, my name is Buikanyo. My question has to do with, for those of us who are still in corporate and who started companies. Myself and my partner basically are full-time employees. I just want to find out, in terms of the right timing for living without having that source of income that, is currently sustaining you. When would that be, and should you leave, and you are caught up in a situation where you don't have funding to basically enable you to do what you've been doing on the side with your company? What was the right method to go about basically taking that plunge and going full time to your business and living your corporate life?
Okay, hi, I'm Mafa, and I'm an aspiring entrepreneur. I have two questions. I don't know if I'm allowed to ask two questions.
You can ask one.
Okay, this one goes to Aisha. I just want to understand, because your business, from what I understand, is that it's more online-based. And then there was an article, I don't know if I read it correctly, but it said there was you guys got a funding for around 10 million. So what I want to understand is that for an online-based business, you only need a website. So what are you going to do with 10 million? Because you already have a website. So I just want to understand, what do you use that money for? Because I think it's a bit intimidating, because when you want to go online, you're like, I don't have 10, I'm just wondering what is going to be used for. And my second one, I'm allowed, I guess, to ask that. my second one is, I don't know if it's just my problem, but I always have a brilliant idea. You have this good idea, once you try to do it, there's another one that comes up. So how do you guys manage to focus on just that one thing? Or maybe it's just me, I'm too brilliant, I don't know. But how do you guys manage to focus on that one question? Okay, thank you.
Okay, am I answering the third one first? Okay. All right, so on the ideas front, I mean, we have lots of ideas all the time, and what we've learned, and we learned it the hard way, is that it's not ideas that make you successful, it's execution. It's the ability to take even an ordinary idea and make it extraordinary in what you do with it that makes it successful. So you have a good idea. It's kind of like writing a book. You have a good idea for a plot. Everybody has a good idea. They're like, ooh, this would be a good miniseries. But if you actually go out there and write the script and get the actors and film it, then you've got a product. And for me, that's a very big distinction. The ability to execute is key. It's everything.
do with all that money?
With the 10 million. So that thinking around our business is I think exactly why what makes our business so powerful is that people see it and firstly they think, oh, I've had that idea, or I had that idea like 5 years ago and I could totally do it. And then the second thing is it looks like just a website, which it should. That's the point, right? Is that as someone who's coming onto it, all you should see and all you should think about is this interface that you're interacting with and how you use it to make a booking. But there's really a lot that goes on behind that. So we've got a team of about 17 in our office. We're managing over 1,000 cleaners. And the money that we've received, the funding, has been deployed for growing that team. So we're poising ourselves. We've gone past the startup phase, and we're now at the growth phase, at the scaling phase. So it's setting up that team to be able to handle massive scale. And that team consists of, my co-founder is a developer, and now he's added two developers to his team. We have marketing team, we have an operations team, and we have a customer support team. So there's a lot that goes on behind the hood when it comes to that, just that website. You know, that's probably 1% of what SweepSouth is. And the other 99% is, firstly, there's a back end to that website, that the engine that's doing, with lots of algorithms and, you know, that's doing all of the work behind the scheduling. There are people who have to develop that, and they're very expensive. And then there's the operations, and there's the customer support. So it's, you know, it's just, you just see the front end, but there's a lot that's going on behind that. And that's what our investors obviously had to understand that the business needs money to be fueled into it. And again, I often use Uber and Airbnb as an analogy, just because they're these kind of consumer-based businesses that everyone understands, but it's the same thing. Why is Uber, you know, they're worth $50 billion. Why are they raising $1 billion in loans? What, you know, why couldn't they just take out of that 50? It's again that there's a lot that goes on behind it, and to be able to scale, I actually think starting up is very cheap, but I think scaling, you get to a point where it becomes very expensive, and then you kind of hit the slope, and then it becomes cheaper, but it's expensive to scale a business.
Okay, so you asked about goals, and I kind of want to answer the two almost together. So if you don't have a set goal, and if you're still in your previous job, I mean, why do you actually need to make this happen? You've got your job. There's a saying, you know, if you go out to sea, you burn your boats. You can't go back. So in a way for me, okay, quitting my job, I had to make this work. And also setting goals and saying we're going to do this. We said we're going to take 120 students. By the time we said it, we had no money. So then we had to raise that money. And it also helps you to focus. If you have this goal, and so this is what we did in the beginning, because I also have 20,000 ideas a day. But okay, what is the goal? Okay, we need to sign up these corporate customers in our case. Okay, that's the goal, that's the focus. And I don't have another job, so I need to make this happen. So I think it's important to leave your job, actually. While you have that job, you're not going to focus, and you're not going to make it happen because you don't have to. And maybe also, like you say, if you have a family and you have to make it, you know, you have to burn those boats that you can't go back. Then you're going to have the pressure, and then you're going to have to make it work.
Okay, I'm going to be a little more conservative and say, maybe don't quit tomorrow until you know what debt you have and your credit cards and all these good things, because life does go on and you still have to pay the tax man and you still have to pay off your credit card. So I would, at a minimum, make sure you're debt-free. That you, starting a business with debt hanging over you, you need a fresh start. So maybe don't quit tomorrow. I don't know what your financial situation is. I made sure I had some runway and personal savings that I'd built up over time. So I'd let the idea kind of mull in my mind for a long time. And also with the guy who had multiple ideas, some ideas are great at night, and the next morning you think, well, that was crap. Like, what? Who's ever going to build that? Or you see something that's been built and it's shit hot, and you think, I can never do that. So sit on ideas sometimes. Let them incubate, and then they'll tell you whether they're right or not. But yeah, so it's a very tricky line that you're sitting on, because you don't want to be seen to be using companies' time to be building your business. So you need to manage your reputation very carefully, because if you want to go back and sell to that business, You don't want to be positioned as the guy who is using their resources to build this thing that now they've got to pay you for. So also be very careful about that. I see a lot of entrepreneurs trying to do that, trying to use company time to build their businesses, and it's really, it can rot your reputation very quickly. And then goals, yeah, like things I do, literally to help me stay sane, because we all have 40,000 things we have to get through in the day. When I wake up in the morning, I literally say 5 quick wins for the day. If I get through these, today would have been an accomplishment in the business, or I would have felt like I'd accomplished something. Sometimes you get it right, you can't beat yourself up, but yeah, goals critical to everything. Brilliant.
Maria, I'll squeeze in your last question.
I want to touch upon this, and it's the sense of ownership that none of you, I think, have really touched on, and I think it's fundamental in running your own gig, that it's yours and your partner's, and I think that's something that perhaps needs to be mentioned to all of us, because it's fundamental. You know, it's that employer that you left. So suddenly it's yours, and the moment that it's yours, it just takes on a different sentiment. And again, you know, just the buy-in is different. Your buy-in is different. That 20 hours with a 7-year-old kid is different. By the way, my name is Maria. I'm 41, but in essence, I'm 23. I am incredibly inspired, and also by your question, the gentleman there with the grey shirt, the fact that I run a luxury business, in the sense I run a gallery. And I struggle with this distinction between the love of it and the reality of it, because I sell art. But I am here, and the reason I'm here is that I need to change the mindset, my mindset. And that is to move from the semi-pseudo-academic moment of honor to shift into the reality of the necessity of the commercial. And to anyone who's out here, I sure would like some models. That's my comment.
Brilliant. Maria, on that note, I'm going to close this wonderful panel. You heard her. It is your dream, so pay the price. It is your gig at the end of the day. I'm highly inspired. I'm highly motivated by what South Africa has to offer. I believe that we now, in the next stage of our country, where we are not going to drag in all that we have inherited, and we are going to recreate what we deserve as young South Africans. So can we give our panelists a hand of applause? Thank you very much, guys. Thank you very much. And I'm sure you're all wondering where we are. For those who have never been here, we are at AlphaCode, and I'm going to call upon a representative from AlphaCode to say a word or two. Miss Paige Robinson, yes, she's a lady that literally runs the show. She's going to tell us where are we and what do they do here.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Paige, and I'm the head of marketing and operations for AlphaCode. So I know there are quite a few familiar faces here tonight, but for those who haven't been here before, AlphaCode is an initiative of Rand Merchant Investment Holdings, which sits across the corridor. And what we're trying to do here is find the next generation financial services entrepreneurs who are going to reshape the financial services landscape. So we've set it up as a shared working space, which is available to our gold, platinum, and diamond members. And these are members who are building fintech businesses and are working full-time for their businesses, no side projects. But we've set this place up as a home for fintech entrepreneurs, where they can come together. And the reason why we called it a club is, if you think of a running club or golf club, or it's where people who are like-minded come together and sort of feel safe and they share their ideas. And so we've created this as a space where people can come together and we can bring together industry experts, entrepreneurs, investors, mentors, and really kind of bring those walls down and work together to find that next big thing. So welcome to AlphaCode. We hope to see you all again at the next event. And if you want any more information, I'm here. Come chat to me. Great.
Thank you very much.
And just to mention that Annabel and Dario are members of AlphaCode.
Brilliant. Wonderful. So Simodisa as an industry association is loved and supported by a couple of, you know, organizations and corporates, and one particular startup, Payfast. They believe in us creating this enabling environment for entrepreneurs to share, to basically motivate each other. But then also, we need more entrepreneurs in South Africa. We need to create a culture. So I'm going to call upon Rosalind. She's going to tell us about, you know, what Payfast is, and also tell us why are you supporting Startup Thursdays. Thank you, Rosalind.
Can I start with the end? Because we love you guys.
That is easy.
Yeah. Sorry. Hi, everyone. So I'm Rosalind, and I head up business development at Payfast. And what we do is we offer a payment processing service which allows merchants who need to receive funds online. And the nature of our product and kind of why, to some extent, we are involved in a lot of these kinds of events and initiatives that are supporting entrepreneurs is that our product is designed to be useful to entrepreneurs and people starting out, because the product is a multi-layered service that includes a lot of layers that I think a lot of people tend to ignore or not know about or haven't had the chance to figure out what to ask about. So we include layers and support and multiple payment options, which is particularly important in emerging markets in South Africa specifically, and fraud detection. So there's a lot of additional layers involved in their process, and we kind of hide as much of that as possible so that you can get on with your business, and we just keep hold of the payment side of things. So that's kind of why we are also a startup ourselves, or we now are in much more of a scale-up phase. So we don't really consider ourselves a startup anymore, but we kind of understand where you're coming from, where you're coming from. The scale-up is definitely harder, I think. so this is why we are involved in initiatives like Simodisa, and we believe that they are supporting amazingly, and I think that's kind of come up a lot as well in terms of the fact that there is support and you just need to be asking.
Cool. Brilliant. Thank you, Rosalind. And then just to also mention our very special partners that make Simodisa reality, AlphaCode. We are also here. Paige did forget to mention that. Our offices is right here. So Simodisa, this is the home, and we're very, very happy to be able to create these platforms. Department of Science and Technology, you know, they really, really believe in the work that we're doing. They want to put a human face to, you know, the department, that it's not just a department in Pretoria. They also do initiatives, and they also do want to enable a thriving ecosystem for technology entrepreneurs. The South African Venture Capital Association, as we know, VC is one of those missing gaps in our funding spectrum in South Africa. So Simodisa does, we're constantly trying to promote the asset class so that if you have an idea, somebody can give you that 10,000 rands just to start your business. So we're happy to be working with SAFCA. And then last but not least, First National Bank, how can we help you? We're very, very happy to have them on board. CB is here sitting in the front, and we believe in the fact that it's one of the most innovative banks. I think, you know, they've come up with phenomenal initiatives. They don't only support Simodisa, they support Silicon Cape, they support WeThinkCode. So they're really, really playing a very active role in being the banker of entrepreneurs, because they believe in the future that you're creating for yourself. So Sibi, on behalf of Simodisa, I really want to thank you very much for your contribution and also for believing in this platform that's really going to create and make a dent in South Africa. So on that note, guys, thank you very much. We're now going to, yes, a hand of applause. Thank you very much for being here. We're now going to, let you be. Engage, network, have a glass or two of wine, get to know people, and also there's an opportunity to engage with our ultimate panel this evening. Guys, can we give them one last hand of applause? That's going to encourage them to keep pushing, to keep hustling. And, you know, this thing of youth entrepreneurship, it's a reality. There are young entrepreneurs. They are successful. They are scaling businesses. They are going global. So it is possible. If you're anybody that didn't believe it, well, I hope tonight you did. Thank you very much. Oh, the video will play as we now go towards the bar and enjoy our food. Thank you very much.